design procedure. So if you remember, in company tension member also we have discussed the procedure, okay, design procedure. Similarly, for the compression member also there exists a procedure. Let us see what is that procedure. Procedure. Okay, procedure of design for a compression member. So we know that what is the first step in design, whatever it may be, whether it may be design of tension member or compression member or beam, whatever it may be, what is the first step? We should calculate the load. Okay, first is to determine or calculate the load, design load. Okay, first calculate based on which code we are going to calculate it, IS875. Agree or not? Based on that, we should calculate the design load. So calculate design factor load. Design factor load. Okay, so take it as capital P. So this is the design factor load. Clear? Next, what is the next step? Determine design stress. So we represent the design stress with FCD. So for this, we have to assume some values as per IS 800-2007. So those values are for angle strut. It means we are going to use angle as a compression member in truss. Then it is known as angle strut. So for angle strut, FCD is equal to 90 Newton per mm square. For rolled steel beam as column, it means if we use I section as a column, okay, if we use I section as a column, then FCD, design compressive stress, is 135 newton per mm square. So if we use angle as a strut, then 90 design stress. If we use rolled steel beam as a column, then 135. Next, for heavily loaded column, then FCD is equal to 200 kilo newton per mm square. So these are the values. So this we are going to decide as per IS 800-2007. So after deciding the factor load and design stress, what to do? We have to calculate the effective area or required area. Calculate the required area. So here area required is effective area, AE. So how much the AE? AE is equal to P by FCD. Agree or not? So this is also called as AR, area required. So this much of area is required to take the load P. Okay, factor design load. So after this, what to do? So in these two steps, we have used two code books. So what are those two code books? IS 875 and IS 800. After that, so after getting the required area, so select a trisection. Select a trisection from steel table. Steel table to match with there. Okay, so after getting the area, take a steel table and select a section such that that selected section area should match with this AE. It means it should be greater than or equal to that area. So this is the thing. So after selecting this area, so after selecting this section, so we have to calculate and determine minimum radius of gyration. Radius of gyration of a selected section. R minimum, that is known as R minimum. Agree or not? So after selecting a trisection from steel table, determine its minimum radius of gyration. So obviously, each and every detail of that section is mentioned in the steel table. Gross area, moment of inertia, major and minor moment of inertia, minimum and maximum radius of gyration, everything, its dimensions, everything is mentioned in the state table. So then from that determine the minimum radius of gyration and then and also determine effective length based on end condition. So now we have determined minimum radius of gyration and effective based on this we can calculate slenderness ratio. So based on this we can calculate slenderness ratio, which is equal to KL by R minimum. So this is a calculated slenderness ratio. So this calculated slenderness ratio should be less than or equal to permissible slenderness ratio as per IS 800. So the next is check for slenderness ratio. So for this check, the calculated slenderness ratio should be less than permissible slenderness ratio as per IS 800. Okay, so if the selected section slenderness ratio, if a selected section calculated slenderness ratio is not less than permissible slenderness ratio as per IS 800, then what to do? We have to redesign it. Why? Because slenderness ratio plays a major role in the design of compression members. So this is the procedure. The simple. So take the procedure. Okay, so next. So now next, let us see the permissible slenderness ratio values as per IS 800. Okay, so in code book, whatever the slenderness ratio values are given or maximum slenderness ratio values are given, that we are going to discuss now. For tension members also we have discussed it, yes or no? So likewise, for compression member also there exists the maximum slenderness ratio values. So but in compared with tension member, for compression member slenderness ratio plays a major role. So that you should understand, okay? Maximum slenderness ratio. So this is as per IS 800. See, whenever I'm using as per IS 800, it means, so if I don't represent the year, then it is valid for both, or valid in both limit state and working stress method. That means as per IS 800, 1984 and 2007. So if I simply mention as per IS 800 means it is valid in both the methods, that is working state and limit, working stress method and limit state method. Okay. So first, a member subjected to reversal of stress due to dead end live load, then KL by R minimum max should be less than or equal to 180. Okay, so a member subjected to reversal of stress due to dead end live load. So in which structure we are going to see this member? So we are going to see this member in a truss. Okay, compression member in a bridge truss. Okay, so where we are going to see the compression member in a bridge truss? Upper cord member and in between member. Agree or not? In our previous sessions, that is in design of tension member, we have discussed about truss. Agree or not? So there I have shown which members of the truss are subjected to compression, which members of truss are subjected to tension, and which members are subjected to reversal of stress. Agree or not? So it means in that bridge truss, upper cord member and between members. So this is the slenderness ratio. For bottom cord member, the slenderness ratio is 400. Okay, for bridge truss, and upper cord and between member, the slenderness ratio is 180. Agree? Next. A member subjected to reversal of stress due to wind or earthquake load. Then KL by R minimum max should be less than or equal to 250. So it means where we are going to see these type of members? We are going to see these type of members in roof trusses. Okay, compressive member in roof trusses. For a compressive member in roof trusses, the slenderness ratio is 250. For compressive member in bridge truss, the slenderness ratio is 150. Sorry, 180, not 150, sorry, 180. Okay, next. For compression flange, so if you see beam, so beam is subjected to bending. So in that bending, there exist two types of effects, that is bending compression and bending tension. So there also the compression is there or not. So the obviously in which type of cross section we are going to use as a beam? I section. So I section will have two flanges. So one flange subjected to the compression and another flange subjected to tension. So for the compression flange, the slenderness ratio is, should be maximum slenderness ratio should be less than or equal to 300. So these are the slenderness ratio values. So this is about the design of the compression member. So take note.